This is Eric Rentschler.
This is Tony Case.
In 1995, 500 German film historians were asked to name the best German film of all time. That film in their appraisal was Fritz Lang's M. We're going to be talking about what makes this film so important, both as a film and as a historical document, where it comes from, indeed, where it takes us.
Lang begins his first sound film with a gong. Contemporary spectators would have associated this sound with the start of a newscast at the top of the hour. We are watching a reportage and the clock is ticking. The girl moves her hands like the hands of a clock, again pointing out the importance of time. She's playing a game of elimination, and the song is a song about a murder. So murder hangs over this game.
Crucially, we hear the woman, the washerwoman, say, "Can't you hear?" And speaking both to the children and, of course, to the audience.
But the children are out of the frame and disobey. Lang was not in favor of sound film for very good reason. He was one of the pioneers of silent film language. There was even a saying in the trade press, "Has Lang given up?" And it was a full 19 months that it took Lang to actually make a film after he made Frau im Mond, which came out just about when the German film industry turned to sound in 1929. And Lang, interestingly enough, did not want to put a soundtrack under it. So Lang refused to do this with Frau im Mond, and Uwe in a way blamed him for the lack of success of that film. So it was actually almost a sensation when the trade press started to speak about Lang being back in the studio and making another film.
Sound for Lang was something that he had resisted, but when he finally puts his mind to making a sound film, he finds ways, and we'll look at those and talk about those, in which he can make sound an equal partner in film's expressive arsenal. Once again, a temporal marker will catch our attention.
And the temporal marker is audible thanks to the cuckoo clock. In fact, what's interesting about this film is that sound plays off the image and the image plays off the sound. So we sometimes have both. Sometimes we have only the image and we have off-screen sound. Sometimes we have sound but no image. Sound expands, of course, the image. You can imagine a space outside of the frame that you see. And it tends to be a threatening space. And that, I think, ties in with the theme of the film, I mean, that you have a danger lurking outside the frame, as it were. Sound that is off screen connotes danger. And this is basically staging the very structure of the film, I mean, that you have a person that you cannot really see that commits these crimes. And you try to figure out who is that person and is the person your neighbor. The shadow is an homage to expressionist film language, and it basically highlights and it also obscures the word murder.
Wie heißt du denn?
Eddie Beckmann.
Notice here the composition, the bending of the figure of the shadow, matching graphically the bending of the mother who curiously also has a knife in her hand. This is a film that is establishing links with characters that are surprising and not obvious. We talk about this film today as a classic of German cinema, indeed as a hallmark of world film. It's invariably used in beginning courses on cinema. And yet this response and these high appraisals are not altogether in keeping with the film's initial reception.
That is very true. It was not a very popular film. It was a kind of an issue film that was discussed as a film that broached a certain social topic, and that topic is the vigilance and the protection of children. The film is actually based on the case of Peter Curtin, the monster of Düsseldorf. Curtin terrorized Düsseldorf between February 1929 and May 1930. Curtin's trial lasted only 10 days, from 13th of April to the 22nd of April 1931. Now, Lang's film came out 11th of May of 1931, so you can see how incredibly topical this film was.
Spannend, aufregend, sensationell.
Ja, ja. Oh, ein Blick, Herr Gerke. Sagen Sie mal, Herr Gerke, ja? Haben Sie Elsa schon nicht gesehen? Nee.
What I find interesting is that the editing of the film suggests that Elsa's murder is committed precisely at the time when Mrs. Beckmann gets her latest installment of serial fiction, which is praised as thrilling, stimulating, and sensational.
So the serial fictions that are being hawked here are rhyming with the serial murders that are being presented in this film.
Exactly, and the seriality of the serial fiction is common to both murder and its representation. The crime that is committed seems to exist already in fiction. Or put another way, the purchase of crime fiction substitutes the real crime. It's kind of self-reflexive moment on the status and function of feature films like M that sell crime as fiction.
The telephone wires that suggest the world of modern communications. The image goes dark once again.
For about 10 seconds, setting off the first few minutes of the film as a kind of a prologue to which the rest of the film responds. These telephone wires might have actually transmitted the news being hawked now in the streets.
News, serial murders that become the grist for news. This news is sold to ready consumers, a quintessential long shot from above. Once again, we see the murderer from the back by indirection. We hear some off-screen whistling. It's Grieg's Peer Gynt, Hall of the Mountain King. We don't know the source of that whistling here.
And it's interesting that he's addressing the letter to the presse, that means to the newspapers. For 1931, this would have immediately flashed up a memory of Peter Curtin and the mass murder trial that was held before this film was shown.
Mass murder, then, and mass media are of a piece, the reiteration of the question, who is the murderer? But it's positioned, that is to say, it's couched within a number of other attractions, a number of distractions that Berlin audiences could partake of. So that this is a property that is sold to consumers, and the consumers greedily stand around wanting to hear more.
dass es die heiligste Pflicht jeder Mutter, jedes Vaters ist, mehr als je ihre Kinder vor der Gefahr, in der sie ständig...
What we think is a radio voice turns out to be a voice of a person in a Stammtisch, which is the German word for a gathering of men smoking, drinking and talking politics. Lang is making this look quite grotesque in the tradition of George Grosz with caricatures of the middle class.
Yeah, the figures look somewhat reptilian. We'll get some close-ups that even stress that more. Again, a typical Lang setup, a circle from which one figure will be excluded, very much reminding us of that initial point of departure in the film.
What this sequence is really doing is showing how a collective hysteria develops out of this sense of uncertainty and fear of the hidden murder.
Yeah, mass contagion is generated by the mass media. We see the copy of Tempo, the Berlin newspaper, lying on the table there. We'll see Tempo throughout the film, but it's this newspaper story that has generated this altercation, and the atmosphere of mass contagion is very much a function then of the newspaper culture and its culture of headlines.
Du, wir zwei, wir sprechen uns vor Gericht, du! Das spreche ich an die Zuchthaus, aber ich habe du Verleumder, du gemeiner Ehrabschneider!
So eine Verleumder, so eine Ehrabschneider!
Now we start moving to spaces that are not localized. Clearly, it's not like Law and Order where we get titles telling us where we are, but there are links by cues, by word cues, taking us from one space to another as the investigation tries to track down the murder, tries to follow up the clues.
Gerade darum muss die Polizei doch hier noch so kleine Spur verfolgen. Jeder Mensch auf der Straße kann der Täter...
Little girl once again asks for the time. Again, we're going back to the street as a site of danger and uncertainty.
And this scene brings also a class dimension into it, a petty bourgeois man, a avuncular figure, this towering proletarian figure speaking, of course, with this inimitable Berlin accent.
In an exaggerated point of view shot.
And crucial in this scene is the way that they become an object of attention. Single individuals give way to many individuals, except they're no longer individuals. The mass here, very quickly, and this is the whole point, I think, of the sequence, the mass will become a mob.
Platz machen, meine Herrschaften. Den Eingang frei machen.
Bei kleinen Tassen sie festnehmen. Das können wir, weiter können wir nicht. Fangt doch lieber den Kindermörder.
Was? Der Kindermörder?
Kindermörder?
Weitergehen. Nicht nehmen.
Weitergehen.
The letter we've seen being written is now a letter that has been mediated. It's in a newspaper. The newspaper, we can even see the date, that it's Monday the 17th. The letter, then, and its public resonance. This is going to be what is going on here, and it takes on political dimensions.
Indeed, in the case of Curtin, the failure of the police to detect the child murderer for like 8 months led to a political crisis. We see in the next few scenes something that looks like a police training film in which the chief of police shows the various ways in which crime is detected, starting with fingerprint cards, and there were about 1 million fingerprints on file in 1930 in police headquarters in Berlin.
Noch irgendeinen brauchbaren Fingerabdruck festzustellen. Trotzdem wird auch hier nichts unversucht gelassen, um durch eingehendste Vergleiche mit unseren Karteien vielleicht doch noch irgendetwas Verwendbares zu finden, das uns der Lösung des Problems näher bringt. Anschließend geht der Brief direkt zur graphologischen Begutachtung.
Then we see an analysis of the handwriting, slightly comically conveyed by Lang with the Kafka-like bureaucratic setup in which a graphologist dictates a report on the handwriting.
Die pathologisch starke Sexualität dieses Triebmenschen. Punkt. Die zerbrochene Schreibart mancher anderer Buchstaben ist in ihrer zeichnerischen Weise ein Ausdruck.
This is our first direct view of the murder, except it's not really direct, it's a reflection.
But it's defined by voiceover. And notice that the cutaway starts with play acting, it ends with madness. Lorre grimaces to make himself look crazy. He tries to play act what the others think of him.
So the letter is a form of appeal to the police, and in a sense, in its own right, a performative act. We then have this image in the mirror, which is performing itself, performing its madness.
Das Resultat.
Herr Minister, meine Leute haben in der Woche keine 12 Stunden Schlaf mehr.
And here we have, as Tony was talking about, a series of images that very much look like a police training film, and in a sense confirming what the one official is telling the other about the vicissitudes that the various officers have before them.
It may actually refer back to what they called a Polizei show, a public exhibition of police methods in 1926 in Berlin, which was a big hit with the public.
Sie stehen ununterbrochen auf dem Sprung, jede, aber auch die geringste Spur aufzunehmen, denn möglicherweise kann ja gerade sie zum Ziele führen. Bedenken, Herr Minister, allein die Arbeit am Tatort.
Note well here, this garden, the Schreber Garden, is indeed a studio space. This film has next to no location shooting. It's a film that somehow works very much in the confined space of a constructed world, and yet it gives us a sense of a city as it lives and breathes, down to the most minute detail, like these shards of sugar in this box of confections.
In jeder Konditorei, in jedem kleinsten Kolonialwarengeschäft nach dem Ursprung dieser Tüte geforscht. Umsonst. Mit jedem Tag.
And as we can see, what this film is doing is mapping the city, mapping it in various ways, traversing its various living spaces, its various workspaces. Not doing so in an obvious manner, doing so in a quite elliptical one. We've seen this in innumerable police procedural films, but this is a film that is doing this in a very original way.
Immer ins Ungewisse hinein, zunächst ohne Aussicht auf einen wirklichen Erfolg, der uns dem Ziel.
It's the principle of seriality once again, in which one scene connects with the other by way of an illustration. It is not Brechtian, because it misses the political dimension, but it is a kind of serial quality, an additive quality that illustrates the work of the police.
Herr Minister, scheinen doch nicht die rechte Vorstellung von den ungeheuren Schwierigkeiten zu haben, mit denen die Kriminalpolizei zu kämpfen hat. Ist Ihnen bekannt, dass zum Beispiel über den Heimweg, den das vermisste Kind genommen haben soll, allein 15 gänzlich verschiedene Zeugenaussagen bestehen. Ich werde Ihnen ein x-beliebiges Beispiel herausgreifen. Bitte, Zeugenvernehmung Nummer 1478, Mordsache Beckmann.
Sie haben keine Ahnung. Mehr wissen Sie, Herr.
Here we have a scene that is one of the set pieces meant to demonstrate the unreliability of witnesses. This goes back to what we know about the Curtin trial, in which thousands of clues were delivered, but hardly any panned out.
Schluss,
hat ja keinen Zweck. Ich danke Ihnen, meine Herren.
Bitte.
In some ways, one might talk about this film in the same breath as Alexander Derblin's novel of 1928, Berlin Alexanderplatz, Derblin thought of this novel as giving expression to the thousand voices of the big city. In its own reduced kind of way, that is what M does as well. We see the big city. We see the big city as a source of conflicting energies. We see it at times as a source of chaos and confusion. And for that reason, it needs to be monitored and administered. And that's why this film is so emphatic in its attention on the technologies of security and observation, these means by which you can register the comings and goings of so many different people. I think an insight by Friedrich Kittler here is very much to the point. Quote, from the National Postal Service to the public telephone to the license plate on every registered vehicle, media are at work replacing people with their addresses. The world is becoming more abstract, and that surely enacts a certain kind of human price, particularly in a case where things are becoming streamlined and rationalized. Someone whose behavior doesn't fit into that becomes all the more deviant, sticks out all the more, and becomes all the more of a source of irritation.
This is a typical noir scene in lighting and setting. Wet streets, extreme camera angle, harsh shadows, pools of lights, car lights. Lang's visual style in M has been highly influential for American film noir in the 1940s and 50s, including his own film noirs and films from numerous other exiles from Hitler Germany.
You'll notice that this police raid here is a logistic intervention. It's like a military action. It's staged with the greatest precision. We get just bits and pieces, but we know what is transpiring and we have a sense of what is up.
The scene is shot in complete silence, and it is a fact that two-thirds of the film was shot in sound, one-third as a silent film. The reason being, in part, that the license fees for sound equipment were so expensive that they wanted to save. But there's another reason. A certain eeriness comes with this silence that is broken only by a loud whistle from off-screen, followed by other whistles, and once again, slightly mysterious and scary since we don't know where it comes from. Shots of panic and escape toward the camera, some escape, but the camera's perspective is that of the police. The camera is in cahoots with the police.
As so often in Long, the world with the structure of a trap, the off-screen presence that marshals these people, that pushes them back into this underground bar, and also, in its own way, anticipates the arrival of a key presence. You'll notice here lots of studied uses of the architectural spaces, of the arches, but also, as we'll see very shortly here, the use of shadows. If the murderer is introduced as a shadow with a bowler hat, so too is Lohmann. Lohmann is a king. You could also talk about him as a father coming to his unruly children and asking them for order.
Not even Lohmann thinks. I would assume that most people in the audience would assume that he finds the murderer among those folks. It's like a show put on to prove that something is done.
And the show must go on. The show has a certain kind of mise-en-scène to it. And in this choreography, certain figures try to break out of something that has been preordained. We get an inventory of the various objects in the place. We have a kind of uncanny moment where a jacket somehow assumes almost a human semblance.
Alex, Alex!
Menschen noch kein Handgeld!
doch keine Geschichte, hat doch keinen Zweck. Wer keinen Ausweis hat, kommt mit zum Alex.
In the background, we hear the word Alex mentioned several times. It refers to Berlin's biggest police complex at the Alexanderplatz. It was there since the 1890s, and Lang was said to have done research there for the film.
Ausweise bereit halten. Wo ist der Ausweis?
Aber Herr Kommissar, ich kann nicht ewig mein Geburtsschein mit mir rumschleppen. Nicht, das geht doch wirklich nicht.
Mecker nicht,
nein,
mein
Herr
Kind.
Kommissar, es geht kann ich wirklich nicht.
Alex.
Police here are arrayed as almost geometric forms, reminding us, say, of the soldiers in the hallway in the Nibelungen, for instance. Otto Wernicke plays Lohmann very much as a man of the people. These are individuals he knows, as I said. They're like his family or like his children. He's dealt with them before. He addresses them by their first name. He knows their tricks. This is basically choreographed and staged.
And it shows there is a working relationship between the criminals, between the underworld and the police, that is definitely interrupted by the serial killer.
Alex.
Auf Wiedersehen, Willi. Winke, winke.
Ach, lach mich. Ja, ja. Nächste.
Lohmann is modeled after the charismatic police detective Ernst Gennert, who was directly involved in helping to resolve the mysterious child murders in Düsseldorf in 1929. He wrote several articles on the Curtin case in the Kriminalistische Monatshefte with all the details of detective work.
Hat ihn schon.
Another Berlin newspaper. We see a date here as well. This is a film that takes place in the here and now that would be familiar to the audiences watching it.
Weiter.
Ach, bist du reingefallen.
Nächste. Papier.
Haben wir dich.
Alex.
Pech ab.
Weiter, der nächste.
Here we have Long's inimitable use of props. We get the first of what we will have many inventory shots, where tools of the trade are put on display very much as you would expect in a police training film or in a Kultur film. This is, in a way, putting that criminal world and its gain and its tools on exhibition for us. These inventory shots, this sober regard, the facts, just the facts, it's very much in keeping with the so-called new objectivity, this movement in German culture of the mid-20s that simply takes in the world as it is with a cold regard, a very sober look at the world.
Basically a documentary look at the world that does not have any expressionistic distortion, but just basically the facts and nothing but the facts. In this scene, we have the barkeeper calling the child murderer a beast in anticipation of the kangaroo court. And after seeing these bumbling fools before, one would agree with her. Lang plays out this scene so long to draw a contrast between the jolly common criminals and the serial killer, who is a mentally ill loner. Her arguments foreshadow the arguments made in the kangaroo court at the end of the film.
You might very well recognize the woman here. Of course, this is Rosa Valletti, whom you will have seen in The Blue Angel, one of the performers in that film.
And Blue Angel just came out 3 months before M.
Wenn er kleine Kinder spielen sieht. Wenn die die Bestie unter die Finger kriechen, Brennholz würden sie aus dem machen, kann ich Ihnen sagen.
Fertig zur Abfahrt, Herr Hauptmann.
This sequence here will reiterate some of the motifs and preoccupations that we are quite well aware of by this time. These figures, likewise, will be fleshed out. We'll see that they are not just any criminals. They are representatives of their trades. It's essential to look at this social space here and see that it is, you know, a criminal's apartment, to be sure, but it's one that has bourgeois trappings, even if all of the different pieces don't add up into a fully convincing ensemble.
Again, the question of time is brought up. One of them even makes a phone call to an office to find out the exact time.
Again, to reiterate one of the preoccupations, another inventory and another taking stock of objects laid out before us for our study.
This is a culture of nervousness in which time is measured not in minutes or hours, but in terms of seconds. Lang lets us wait full 2 minutes in real time before the next major player is introduced. That is Schrenker, who is the head of the organized crime ring. The scene is tinged with irony about the honorable profession of a criminal, a motif that was central to Brecht's popular play, The Threepenny Opera, which premiered in 1928 in Berlin. The gangster is a troubled businessman who tries to make it in a tough world, is still a powerful formula in mass culture, like in Sopranos, for instance.
Die hat so eine Kleine von 6 Jahren. Also jede Nacht habe ich das Vergnügen, dreimal unter das Bett und unter das Kanapee zu kriechen, ob sich da vielleicht der Mörder versteckt hat. Deinen Beruf kannst du nicht mehr nachgehen, weil du dauernd über Kriminale stolperst. Privatleben hast du auch nicht mehr. Ich kann euch sagen, ich habe das satt.
Neuigkeit. Und bloß der Schränker bleibt.
As ever, the table is round. Of course, one of the parties is missing, and that absence is duly noted for us, that unoccupied chair at the middle of the frame. Time is stretched out. We, like the criminals, are forced to wait.
Culture of nervousness is also underscored by this excessive smoking that could be traced back to the culture of nervousness that you had in the trenches, for instance.
A lot of people have seen M as a historical allegory, you know, and the argument would be something like this, that the pre-Hitler mass contagion mirrors this climate of opinion that's going to give rise to National Socialism. That, of course, is an argument that looks forward. What about if we look back to World War I? Could one talk about this film as something that has to do with that experience?
I would think so, because, in fact, Fritz Lang wrote a diary. It's actually not a diary. It's a kind of a notebook where he jotted down ideas for the film. And in one entry, he says, war seen as an excuse of the child murderer before the underworld court. That basically means that he was planning at one point to flash back to the trenches and have the serial killing as a continuation of the serial killing that happens during the war, and that the trauma of the serial killing that happens during the war can never stop.
Schön, wir brauchen uns nicht lange bei der Vorrede aufzuhalten. Wir wissen ja alle, warum wir hier sind. Ein Außenseiter verdirbt uns das Geschäft.
One could probably say that the First World War is the subtext, the historical unconscious of all film production in the Weimar Republic. You have that in chamber film, where you have men not coming home. You have it in Metropolis, where you have explosions and wounded. You have it in all kinds of other motifs of trauma.
Well, that might very well explain here why we actually see children, we see next to no fathers,
or when
we
exactly.
And we surely see next to no intact families.
Right.
That, in a way, that experience of war has left social traces and, in a sense, has disrupted the world at large and the workings of a domestic sphere and the ability, in a sense, of a society to reproduce itself.
In unseren Kreisen. Meine Herren, wenn sich mir bei Ausübung meines Berufs ein Kriminalbeamter den Weg stellt, dann weiß er, welches Risiko er eingeht, und ich weiß es auch. Wenn einer dabei drauf geht, im Beruf gestorben, schön, geht in Ordnung, aber
what we see in a minute is an astonishing crosscut from the meeting of the underworld to the police headquarters. An armed gesture begun by Schrenker is continued by the police president. This virtuoso type of editing creates a parallel between the two sides, and it underscores the power of the murderer to make opposite parties, the police and the underworld, forget their differences.
Ohne durch die Überhand nehmende Nervosität der Kriminalpolizei andauernd gestört zu werden. Ich bitte, sich dazu zu äußern, meine Herren.
Verhärfung der Passkontrolle?
Durchsieben der ganzen Stadt? Razzien. Immer neue, immer schärfere Razzien. Spitze.
These are, in a sense, appendages that are part of a larger body. They are functioning in tandem. They are functioning in tandem in a desire to find that which is ultimately invisible and anonymous, anonymous in a society that is virtually open, that is large, that it grants people free movement. How do you make that which cannot be seen and cannot be apprehended, how do you make that visible and, in a sense, tangible?
Durchsuchung seines Besitztums nach irgendwelchen Spuren durchzuführen. Wenn man, wir haben da unsere Verbindung, wenn wir einen Artikel in die Zeitung brächten, dass wir Ringvereine, sozusagen wir Organisierten, großen Wert darauf legen, mit diesem Schwein nicht in einen Topf geworfen zu werden, dass die Polente diesen Kerl ganz woanders suchen sollte als bei uns. Das ist doch gar kein richtiger...
One additional word about the excessive smoking. In both camps, smoking has become the most obvious ways to signify nervous tension, and the billowing smoke manages to cloud any sharp distinctions between the two parties.
Vielleicht spielt er in normalem Zustand mit den Kindern seiner Wirtin Murmeln, oder er kloppt mit dem Mann Skat. Ohne diese, ich will mich mal ausdrücken, private Harmlosigkeit bei Mördern, ist es doch gar nicht denkbar.
Some arguments refer by name to previous serial killers like Hamann and Grossmann, of which Hamann, I think, is the more important one. For instance, there are descriptions of Hamann that make Peter Lorre look like as if he were modeled after Hamann's physiognomy. So there is a kind of a blending between the Hamann murder, which was very much in the public mind, in the collective mind at that time, and the Curtin murder.
I mean, Hamann was a criminal who very much knew how to play the media, right?
Absolutely. He was considered to be absolutely brilliant in the manipulation of the media. He said that he got all his ideas from the press and from reading about Jack the Ripper, and he wanted to be in that tradition.
I mean, Hamann has been subsequently rendered cinematically in Uli Lomo's film of the early 70s, The Tenderness of the Wolves, and more recently in Romuald Kamakar's film The Deathmaker, Der Todmacher, in the mid-90s.
There is something fascinating about Hamann, also in the sense that a philosopher in the 1920s by name of Theodor Lessing argued that the serial killing of Hamann can be related back to the serial killing that happens during the war. And he uses this wonderful phrase. He says one should not judge a snake without judging the marsh from which the snake gets its nourishment. And so he says one should judge Hamann in terms of the larger social and cultural context within which this kind of serial killing was possible.
Ich meine, die ausgesetzte Belohnung ist auch viel zu gering. Herr Präsident, ein Vermögen müsste dem Auffinder des Mörders winken.
Das ist alles kein neuer Weg. Das ist alles nicht.
Na, aber was dann?
Sollen wir vielleicht warten, bis die Polizei den Kerl erwischt hat?
Die Schwierigkeiten bei der Aufklärung gerade derartiger Verbrechen sind erfahrungsgemäß geradezu ungeheuerlich.
So, in a sense, the serial killing goes back to the, you know, mass killing of war, and the serial killing also is related to the serial fictionality and the serial discourse that comes of it. It's sort of, there's a way in which the one spawns the other.
This is what Lang calls the mass murder complex, and I think Lang manages to bring that out, the seriality principle of the press that needs to have new material every day, and the serial killing that basically provides that fodder. for the press. And Lang is quite brilliant in bringing out this connection.
This is very modern insofar as we can think of the murder, you know, working with the mass media, and in a sense, the mass media also needing the murder in as a source of news, as a source of sensation.
Exactly.
I mean, this is a film very much from the straight from the headlines. It's a film that is enacting scenarios very well known to people at the time who are watching the film, who would follow these cases in a way. It's a film that is responding to current events and recycling them in the form of this crime fiction.
Here's a quote from Theodor Lessing, who wrote a book about Hamann and his trials. This is a description of Hamann, but it might as well have been a description of Peter Lorre. He had a coarse, rough, shiny full moon face. The physiognomy was noticeably tight, trapped in the grip of the self. But at the same time, he appeared to be unbelievably talkative, wanting sympathy and hyperactive. His voice, mushy, smarmy, and close to a treble, was like the querulous voice of an old woman. His whole disposition was androgynous, not masculine, not feminine, not childlike, but a combination of all three.
Alle Fürsorgeanstalten, Gefängnisse, Nervenkliniken und Irrenanstalten zu schärfster Mitarbeit angeregt werden.
The discussions are coming to a conclusion. This really striking use of off-screen space, in a sense, the attention oriented to a speaking voice that we don't see. Back then, again, to another scene with a map, but another strategy. Rather than the concentric circles, an attempt to encompass the space, the fist over the city. If the murderer was introduced as a shadow, if Lohmann was introduced as a shadow, Schrenker does not appear here, first of all, as a shadow, but as the meeting goes on, we ultimately see him then also become a shadow. In a way, they are linked in terms of the recourse to a kind of an expressionist staging and, in a sense, to shadowy figures projected in the dark.
Die Bettler. Die Organisation der Bettler.
We see a long shot that captures romantic and, as many critics at that time said, romanticized life of hobos, beggars, and old Berlin originals. Lang, in general, includes much Berliniana in his film, in the tradition of the painter Heinrich Zille, who died in 1929, extremely popular painter and illustrator. Lang shows a similar, almost anthropological interest in the way these beggars spend their day, eating, drinking, and sleeping.
Schwarz seid ihr, Luders!
Seeing the film, it's actually hard to believe that there are 4.5 million people that were affected, because we see such a small variety or such a small range of people, such a small section. But again, I think that goes back to the notion that this is an abstract film. It's a parable, like a Kafka parable, in which we basically see what happens once a community is hit by trauma. How do you react to this, and how an event is processed, how an event is actually dealt with in a community, what an event like mass murder is doing to a community.
Schwarzer Freitag in Prag.
If you watch very carefully, you can see the window pane slide so that the sleight of hand with the camera becomes at least understandable and readable on a technical level, but it nonetheless is a virtuoso movement.
Von 1 bis 88.
The registration follows the example of the conscription in the early days of World War I, except that this is now the home front.
And like Lohmann in the scene that we saw in the bar, Schrenker monitors the proceedings. He is, in a certain way, the master of ceremonies. Once again, the mapping of a city, making certain that every space in the city is somehow observed, is spoken for. It is redolent, in a certain way, of the future organization of the Nazi state.
3795, Emil Dust Hermann.
3795, Dust Hermann.
Emil Dustermann has a wooden leg, which in the period clearly marked him as a war veteran. He was one of those dotting the streets of Berlin, constant reminders of the war.
This is one of Long's compelling experiments with sound, where, in a sense, we become privy to the subjective experience of sound. We hear what a character hears or does not hear.
Another shot of a Hinterhof, in which war veterans who often were hurdy-gurdy-men play. In a few seconds, you see a father and his daughter walking by a couple of posters. If you look closely, West Front 1918, which is a film by G.W. Pabst that came out by Nero Film in 1930.
And this is not just arbitrary. It obviously is the same studio, but it's taking us back to the experience of war, which this film works through, but which the film we're watching now, M, also reflects. You know, the wooden leg here is a palpable effect of the war, and the war wounded line the street in the form of beggars. We know that Lohmann was modeled to a certain degree on Ernst Gennadt. I mean, what else can we say about Gennadt that would be pertinent here?
Well, he was known because of his enormous weight as der volle Ernst, the full Ernst, or the Buddha.
But der volle Ernst is also the full seriousness, right?
Full seriousness, that's the pun. Gennadt was police chief for 30 years, and he's credited with the modernization of crime detection in Germany. For instance, he designed a vehicle called Mordauto, a murder car that housed all tools and materials needed on the site of a crime. And in 1926, he introduced a new specialized homicide division called Inspektion Mord, also abbreviated as M Division. And that actually might have influenced Lang's choice of title. So everyone at that time knew what M Division meant.
Gennadt was involved with the Curtin case as well, no?
Exactly. He was a consultant for the Düsseldorf murders. And what was quite remarkable, and Lang drew on that, is a series of articles that he wrote in the Kriminalistische, in a trade paper for criminologists called Kriminalistische Monatshefte. And there's a series of articles in which all the details about the detection methods and failures and successes of the Curtin case were recorded. He also, and that is, I think, the most interesting thing, is he also wrote about the psychosis that followed the murder. In other words, he was not only interested in detection, but what a murder case like this does to a community, and that the community goes basically crazy and mimics almost the madness of the murder. And Lang has learned a lot from this, and he takes a lot of details from these articles.
But, I mean, subsequently in interviews, Lang seemed to disavow the relationship between what we see in the film and the Curtin case.
Yeah, that's an interesting case. If you look at the press coverage at that time, Lang was actually said to have made a curtain film. So he was considered to be part of the curtain industry. All the press was interested in curtain, and Lang capitalized on that.
Danke, sehr freundlich.
The newspaper we see once again bearing a date, the Generalanzeiger, a right-wing newspaper,
right.
One of the 140 daily newspapers in Berlin at the time, some of which appeared as much as three times a day. The police officer here is monitoring every inch of the space, trying to confirm his suspicions. We, as a spectator, have a head start on him. We surely know what is already the case. In a way, the police are slow in coming to a conclusion that we're already allowed to share. So really, suspense is not the issue here as much as watching a process, a social dynamic unfold. Will the police get it right? Will the police get it right before the criminals?
In that sense, it's a very analytical film. It basically shows us not a storyline, but it shows us the process very much like Brecht would do. Brecht always said that it is not the outcome of a story, but it's the process that is important.
And in this processing of reality, refuse plays such an essential role. That which is discarded is important, is expressive. These are social traces, and this film has really an obsessive preoccupation with refuse.
Beckert throws away the core of the apple as he walks the street.
Another one of those moments where a refuse plays a crucial role as a detail. Beckert is inordinately oral. He constantly has something in his mouth. You'll notice him munching on this apple as he's framed by the knives, as he looks into the window and sees all of the commodities on display. You'll notice how here, very shortly thereafter, he goes into this swoon of sorts, sees this object of his fantastic desire framed as well by knives.
The window display is crudely symbolic with sexual associations. The inanimate things become charged with life by the sheer powerful emotions that radiate out from Beckert and animate everything in sight. This is a scene reminiscent of the so-called street film from the early 20s, a genre of Weimar cinema that addresses the experience of a new urban modernity that comprises sex and crime,
as well as errant male desire. And here, in this case, perverse male desire. If the camera has been stalking her in keeping with his perspective, it now stalks Beckert. The camera is relentless in the way that it stalks figures, chasing them through the streets, following their every move. He clutches his hands as if to get a grip on himself.
And enters a cafe, and he's barely visible. He's like a beast in the jungle. The camera becomes an instrument of surveillance.
Kaffee, bitte. Nein, einen Wermut. Nein, Cognac. Cognac. Cognac.
Camera tracks in. Watching this scene, we assume the perspective of the camera. The camera basically becomes a third force to hunt the murderer. It is a policing eye that trails him and observes him. There's no ambient noise. And Lang always argued that if one is engaged in a conversation, you do not hear what is around you. And what we have here is basically subjective noise, very expressionistic use of noise, only the whistle that where we actually do not know where it comes from. Peer Gynt was staged in Berlin in 1928 in a famous production by Bertolt Viertel, which Lang almost certainly had seen, with Werner Krauss, well known from playing Dr. Caligari, in the main lead. M's frenzied mob, yelling and shrieking like the trolls, enact the command that Beckert's own whistling of the Peer Gynt tune had conjured up all along. A subtle use of sound to exteriorize his subconscious while suggesting the punishment he expects and wants. Lang utilizes sound not only traditionally for dialogue and communication, but also for the expression of the unconscious of a character or a situation.
Was war da doch gleich? Ariston? Ich möchte die Akten.
What is crucial in this scene, of course, is an act of memory. This scene as well brings us another act of memory. But instead of a visual trace, it's an aural trace.
The whistling that came up to that point from nowhere betrays a split between sound and body, and he is identified at the precise moment when the blind beggar puts sound to body.
And what we will have here is a curious collaboration between the man who hears and the man who sees, and the two together will be able to localize the criminal. It is, in a sense, the two need to be collaborators, but it is the blind person who senses more clearly and allows that pinpointing of the criminal who's managed to elude everyone who can otherwise see.
This is, of course, the blind seer with a mythological connotation, the blind seer, Tiresias, the mythological figure from Oedipus who predicted that Oedipus will kill his father.
And this studied use of off-screen space, this pursuit is already on, as it were, at least in the imagination of the film, in this not shown off-screen expanse of street. And you'll notice here again, this is a Berlin that is not one of public monuments, not one of well-known buildings. It's not one even of recognizable neighborhoods. It's in some ways a generic Berlin. It's the idea of a city. A studio city, but nonetheless a city that somehow makes sense, is one that one can read coherently. And you even have, of course, street names replicated here. Another one of these framed shots through a window with a kind of graphic disturbance as well. Beckert, as ever, associated with orality, with consumption, childlike in that way himself, even though murderous through it all. And what we see is framed by the perspective of an off-screen observer. We are, in a sense, aligned with that spy who lurks behind the scenes.
camera goes into close-up, and this goes to a very famous shot of the knife with heavy phallic symbolism. And what we have now is a close-up of Lang's own hand, as you can see in the sweater.
Note as well, once again, the refuse of the orange peels. As ever, orality somehow seems to be commingled with refuse. This little girl herself could be thrown away. The M that marks him, indeed, what does M stand for? Does it stand for murderer? Or is it just an arbitrary signifier? M, when you look at it backwards, it still is an M. This M that is a reflection, in a certain way, of a larger society, as well as a mark of this individual, this deviant individual.
Der Tisch war doch kein alter Holztisch. Naja, er kann ja den Brief auch woanders geschrieben haben. Aber... Das Fensterbrett.
The police in their pursuit of visual evidence are simply behind. It's been the oral evidence that's been the conclusive lead here. There's been a very, very clear distinction between the emphasis on the oral as opposed to the visual.
By the way, the title M was chosen only 3 weeks before the opening. Lang claimed that the original title, Murderers Among Us, was changed because supposedly the Nazis were thinking that the film is about them. Well, if you read the trade press, it clearly says that the title Murderers Among Us was changed because there were two or three other titles with the word murder in it that were planned to be shown in 1930. So it was for marketing reasons that this title was dropped and another title was picked. And for several weeks, the film was actually without any title. And the trade press always made fun that this is the film only title, the film without title. I mean, so in a way, one sees how Lang kind of mythologizes the notion of being anti-Nazi before the Nazis even came to power.
What is striking, though, even if we are less want to see these stories as ones that have much truth value, there is a way in which the way Lang tells them is in the manner of a Lang film, that when he enacts what he claims transpired between him and a studio official as they were trying to make M, or when he describes, even more strikingly, his supposed conversation with Goebbels, there is this constant reference to a clock that he was watching outside the window and this, you know, sense of time passing and could I get to the bank in time before I leave the country? So it becomes figured in a quintessentially long way as a kind of question of the ticking of a clock.
Onkel.
Was denn?
Du hast dich ja ganz weiß gemacht.
Wo denn?
Da auf der Schulter.
The letter M, a signifier with endlessly proliferating meanings, the most obvious ones being murder, murderer, or mensch, human being, condenses all previous markings, handwriting and clinical reports and so on, and finally stigmatizes Beckert for anyone to see.
If M provides a stigma that identifies this figure, we have to think back to the opening sequence of the film, to that child's game where one person becomes the person who is out, who is, in a sense, eliminated. And that whole act, then, of eliminating a certain figure and making that figure no longer part of the circle is very much what has happened to Beckert at this point.
Hier raus ist er auf keinen Fall. Wir hätten ihn sonst unbedingt ziehen müssen.
Ausgeschlossen. Da muss er hier im Hof sein. Zurückgelaufen ist er auch nicht.
Verdammt nochmal, irgendwo muss doch der Kerl sein.
Well, one might say, of course, that M is a war film, a film about a big city under siege.
Yeah, and curiously, then the police and the criminals, usually adversaries, they become on the same team. But I mean, I'm still wondering how the big city, how you can talk about this in the same breath as war. I mean, were there contemporaries who saw it that way? Or did Long even think about the war when he was making this film?
One could probably point out the famous essay by Ernst Jünger called Total Mobilization in 1930. That deals exactly with the modern city as a kind of a post-war phenomenon.
The thing about world wars is, of course, they mobilize a nation in its entirety, both on the home front and on the battleground. In that way, then, Berlin becomes a kind of site of a battleground here.
Exactly. And you can see this with small pointers, like in Emil Dustermann's war veteran reference. And you can also see it in the bureaucratization of the city. You can also see it in the technological landscape. Basically, First World War was a war waged with the tools of modernity and had an urban spirit, and it was seen that way.
Yeah, I mean, striking. We have two set pieces that involve larger operations. I mean, the police raid and then the criminal raid. And both of them are shown to us as military operations in a certain way.
And I think any audience, any member of the audience in 1931 would have seen them exactly that way.
Sie behaupten, dass der Kerl sich im Hause versteckt hat.
Was ist das für ein Haus?
Was ist das eigentlich für ein Haus?
Ausgesprochenes Bürohaus. Was im Keller ist, weiß ich nicht. Hochparterre ist eine Filiale der städtischen Sparkasse. Vom ersten Stock bis zum fünften sind lauter Büros und darüber ist der Boden.
Ist doch unglaublich. Ist da noch jemand? Hallo?
You'll also note that this film has been very fluid, very meandering in the way that it's gone from one sector of the city to the other. At this point, however, we will stay in this building, in this large office building, for more than 10 minutes. The film has a kind of contracting dynamic to it, where space in the end here becomes smaller and smaller to the point where it's essentially reduced to a building and then to a cellar.
Ja. Aha. Scheint also wirklich, dass der Kerl feststeckt.
This will be a very privileged moment for Grundgen's performance. You'll see, of course, he's in his quintessential leather jacket with the leather glove and the bowler hat, natty as ever. Striking about the performance is the expressive use of his hand, that hand that expresses control, power, but also determination, calculation, and
potential violence.
This seems to be a policeman, and we, just like the character on screen who will appear, are taken in, for the moment at least, by this ruse.
Ist doch nicht möglich. Ich hab doch selber. Aber es ist doch.
at this moment, then the voice makes it clear, as does his face, just who this is.
Los! Vorwärts!
And followed by this ironic whistle tune, Üb immer treu und Redlichkeit, you know, always be loyal and honest, recognizable as a folk tune used in Mozart's The Magic Flute, also, though, used quite expressively in Sternberg's The Blue Angel, a film that came out during the same year.
Ach, Sie wollen nicht antworten, nein?
Schön.
Im Haus sind noch zwei Wächter auf Kontrollgang.
Lang, in a later interview, was asked, were you influenced by Brecht? And Lang responded by saying there was no way one could not be influenced by Brecht at that time. And in fact, Lorre was playing Galligai in Brecht's play Mann ist Mann, Man's a Man, while he was working with Lang on the film.
What's curious about Lang is, you know, there is so much that is, you know, reminiscent of Brecht. Above all, that feeling that the spectator knows more than the characters.
Exactly.
And in a sense, the privileged knowledge we have. And yet, at certain moments, we're duped. And we're, in a sense, given something, and that information proves false. We've been set up. And M is playing tricks on us in a way that Brecht wouldn't play tricks on the spectator.
That's very true. What Lang also wouldn't do is, of course, the political message. In Brecht, you tend to have a moral lesson rather than kind of this ambiguity.
What is striking and frustrating and intriguing, I think, about the final passage of the film is its inconclusiveness. You know,
right.
What are we to carry away with us from this film?
Yeah, I think that also has to do with different impulses in making the film. I think there's the Thea von Harbou impulse that she actually articulates in an article that came out a day after the premiere, in which she asks, why are we making such a film? In this article, she basically argues that the protection of children is as much an issue, or should be as much an issue, as homelessness and unemployment. And she says she made the film in order to instruct people about the danger in which children are in the modern world. And that is, I think, definitely one impulse. And that comes out very clearly in the very last shot or the very last sentence, where the three women say, all we can do, even if the murderer gets the death penalty, all we can do is to be more vigilant about our children. So in that sense, the film has a didactic message, but it's a message that addresses a social problem.
But, I mean, this closing word, and actually we have script evidence that suggests that actually they were closing words, right? The film ends with the appeal of the mother to be more vigilant. And then this word that we have in the print here, you, right, which throws it back on the audience.
Right.
And actually in the script we have you too, ihr auch, right? In a way, it's not exactly Brechtian, but it surely is an address that addresses the audience just as the opening word of the film.
Right. I think it is Brechtian in the sense that it addresses the audience directly and that it's meant to be a message film.
One could surely say that Lang is a moral filmmaker. One probably wouldn't so easily be able to say that he was a moralistic filmmaker in, let us say, the manner of a Brecht who has a certain kind of political impetus and politics that are very clear. I mean, Long's politics, as we know, were not that of the left, at least during this period of history.
Yeah, that comes out very nicely in the discussion about the death penalty. The death penalty was considered to be the main point of the film, which we think, or at least I think, is clearly not the case. So this question of the death penalty, I think, is an interesting one in the sense that the right-wing press basically praised Lang, even though Lang himself said it was a film against the death penalty. So this is an interesting way in which the film shows a kind of ambiguity about the issue.
But Goebbels surely saw this film as pro-death penalty, right. No?
Absolutely. Goebbels, in a diary entry on 21st of May 1931, so he saw the film 10 days after it opened, fantastic, against humanitarian sentimentality, for the death penalty, well made. Lang will be our director one day.
And, of course, Lang would not become their director. And there is, of course, this story very well known about an ostensible meeting between Lang and Goebbels after the Nazis came to power. Of course, there is no record of that in Goebbels' otherwise very fastidiously kept diaries. Likewise, we know quite well that Lang, contrary to what he said, didn't leave Germany shortly after this meeting, but returned to Germany on numerous occasions and would not leave Germany until many months thereafter. And we also know, of course, that Lang was a member of a Nationalsozialistische Betriebsorganisation, a Nazi film workers' outfit. And there may well be a lesson in all of this that, you know, he was in a position of influence. He was offered this possibility, and he made the right choice. And his subsequent career, his subsequent activities with the Anti-Nazi Film League in Hollywood surely bear that out.
Right.
Beckert and his makeshift, utterly inadequate technology. No match for the highly organized, highly specialized criminals. I mean, one professional after another. In the following shots, what is going to stand out above and beyond just the whole notion of this space that it becomes ever more contracted is the way in which light is particularly important here as an expressive element, as a means that allows us to see but also to segment how we see, and in a sense to accentuate the different sectors of the space here. And if you think about, for instance, other films by Lang, say the sequence in Metropolis where Rotfang hunts down Maria with a flashlight, this sequence as well is going to be one in which the criminal above all is apprehended and in a sense caught by the light.
Maybe we should say something about the cinematographer Fritz Arno Wagner, who was one of the most distinguished cameramen of the Weimar Republic. He worked on classical German expressionist films like Fritz Lang's Destiny, 1921, F.W. Murnau's Nosferatu, 1922, classical expressionist film, as well as Arthur Robinson's Warning Shadows, 1923. But he also shot Pabst's surrealistic war films Westfront, 1918, and Kameradschaft of 1931, as well as Three Penny Opera in 1931 also. M is a realistic film in many ways, even a documentary. But its brilliant use of shadows and chiaroscuro lighting betrays its cinematographer's expressionist roots.
If any shot in the film does this, taking us back to the chiaroscuro of expressionism, here is one of them. Note the fierce verticality. Note the way in which these eyes are about ready to bug out, very much in keeping with the cinema of the fantastic and its expressionistic extremes. Again, Peter Lorre becomes almost at one with the various discarded elements here, so trying to blend in with them. He, as a bit of refuse, tries to hide amidst these props, but he can't, and the light, as you see, apprehends him. This logistic enterprise was very efficient from the beginning. In the end, it is equally efficient as the various players pick up their tools and depart. This has been like a military enterprise, a mobilization of a series of troops to carry out a certain mission, and that mission clearly has been accomplished, as we see. What we're going to see in its wake are a series of still lifes. The building has been violated. It's a series of almost photographic stills showing the acts of violence against property, against the building.
The whole burglary seems to echo the infamous break-in engineered by the brothers Franz and Erich Sass. They entered a Berlin bank on the Wittenbergplatz indirectly by digging a tunnel into the bank and stealing huge amounts of money and jewelry from a safe. Much of it was not declared as a loss for fear of being charged for tax evasion. The court at that time actually had not sufficient proof to convict them. These virtuoso gangsters were much celebrated in the 1920s, and Lang seems to have admired their skills.
And again, a use of the circle here, but a curious variation on the theme of the circle, where the figure who is apprehended is in the middle of the circle rather than ejected. In terms of the way we experience a city, you almost feel at times as if the concrete city is giving way to this experience of abstraction, that the city is on the way to becoming a virtual space.
That's an interesting idea. I mean, the whole film is kind of an abstract film. It's like a parable of Kafka rather than a documentary. I mean, it has it both ways. This is what I think makes the film so interesting, is that it is both an abstract parable, it is also a documentary. And Lang manages to have this mythologizing elements in it throughout, plus the documentary shots. So this kind of mixture makes the film both abstract and also very concrete.
Yeah, I mean, Lang used this phrase, a portrait of our times, in Dr. Mabuse the Gambler. And actually, if you think of that as a, you know, historical portrait, a sight film, a film about the times of the inflation period, M is a kind of pendant to it insofar as it's a film about the depression that comes after the stock market crash.
That is true, but M features a completely different type of criminal. In Mabuse, you have the mastermind who knows everything. In M, you have a creature like Peter Lorre, who is basically a victim of society as much as a perpetrator. And that kind of nuance and that kind of dialectic is not to be found in the 1922 film Mabuse.
Mabuse is the master manipulator of the media, of the world of organizations and institutions, and there's a certain way in which he is ubiquitous and omniscient, and there's no such, you know, power that is possible at this point in M, right? Omniscience is not present anywhere.
Except the camera, in an interesting way, in a kind of Brechtian way, is omniscient. In other words, it's kind of an epic camera in the sense that it knows what's happening, it knows what is going on, it knows in advance what's going on. So I think in that sense it's an epic film in the tradition of the epic theater of Brecht, in the sense that it's also serial and additive rather than strongly dominated by a storyline.
Was kann mir schon passieren? Bisschen Sachbeschädigung. Na schön. Geklaut worden ist nicht.
Geklaut worden ist ja, mein Lieber. Und nicht zu knapp.
Was? Geklaut? Wie viel denn?
Erzähl du mir was, dann erzähl ich dir was.
Ich hab schon gesagt, ich weiß von nichts.
Lang here manipulates our sense of temporality. We've had this furious cross-cutting within the building, this frenetic search for the murderer and a certain element of suspense. Now the rhythm changes and we have this protracted sequence of interrogation. And in a sense, we are impatient as an audience that the police get on with the business, that they somehow figure out what we've known long ago.
Lassen Sie mal einen Wächter reinkommen.
Wächter, da mal was?
Bitte setzen Sie sich.
Even in the fast-paced world of long cinema, when you're dealing with the world of the police, the wheels of justice can grind very slowly, as we see in this sequence. And Long is someone who is fascinated by the whole question of procedure and process here. In all of this, there is a desire to somehow measure this world of justice and watch how it works. And in a sense, it works slowly here, more slowly than we as spectators would wish.
Schön. Dann gehen Sie mal vorläufig nach Hause und erholen sich von Ihrem Schreck. Aber halten Sie sich bitte zur Verfügung der Polizei.
Jawohl, Kommissar. Oh, moin, Herr Kommissar.
Moin, moin. Sagen Sie mal, ist Kommissar Lohmann im Hause? Achso, er spricht gerade. Nein, 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 ist nicht nötig, danke schön. Ich komme selbst darüber.
Was? So, noch nicht nach Hause gekommen. Ne. Habt ihr auch auf die Olle, auf die Winkel aufgepasst? Nein. Nein!
At that moment where Lohmann still has not managed to figure out what is up, we get this stunning low-angle shot that makes him look gargantuan, somewhat monstrous, indeed unappealing. I mean, why is that shot there?
You see, this is the low point of his investigation. He's really down and out. He's drinking this horrible coffee and so they have the man, but they know who the man is, but they do not know where he is. And I think the camera is basically trying to pull him down.
Ach, eine Lurke ist das mal wieder.
Ich möchte dich bitten. Na, lies dir mal das erst durch.
Du, okay?
Ja. Einbruch in ein Bürohaus.
Einbruchstraße? Doch eine ganz ordentliche Gegend.
We have yet again a moment where a protocol is read, and what this scene is doing is going to reiterate, and not only reiterate, but extend images we've already seen in the film. It sums up what we've seen, what we already as spectators have come to understand. We revisit the site, we revisit the plans. These are, in a sense, replays of scenes we've seen before, and yet we're being replayed in a context where the police are at wit's end trying to figure out what has caused these acts of violence against the building. We see the evidence they have at their disposal, the written explanations, the visual evidence, the various violated spaces, but curiously, the violated spaces don't involve any acts of robbery. The acts of violence have been for an end that also is not readily understandable. And what the film is doing then is showing us evidence, evidence that we understand, evidence that we've been able to narrativize, and in a sense showing the police and their own inability to somehow make the connections that we have already made. Once again, this is a film that is insisting on the whole process of understanding and putting together information and showing us how minds work.
Roman, wenn du mir dabei helfen wolltest?
Nachtigall? Ich höre dir laufen. Na, dann werden wir uns den Franz mal kommen lassen.
Really, this is not so much a question of any plot or story as it is a question of a larger kind of intelligence and the work of intelligence and the labor of intelligence.
Bereitschaftsdienst, Leiter Kommissar Karl Lohmann. Ja, was habe ich denn mit Ihnen?
This is a film that really doesn't have any heroes. I mean, Lohmann reappears in A Testament of Dr. Mabuse, and he's far more heroic in his function there. But here he is, he is ironized, and in a sense it's not George Grosch, but it's something similar to it from below.
Right. But of course he recovers at the moment he knows what is happening. So what we are basically seeing how this crime detection is written on the body of Lohmann, how it actually makes it a physical appearance on his body. And that, I think, is important in a film that is almost conceived as a silent film.
It's funny in terms of Otto Wernicke's performance here, after this moment where Lohmann's stock is as low as it's going to get, we get then a series of responses. I mean, and it's almost played in a kind of slapstick manner, with the cigar dropping from his mouth, with the water tapped on his face, recognition.
That always produces a lot of laughter among my students when he drops the cigar, simply because we are way ahead of him and we think this is somewhat histrionic gesture and not quite necessary.
And also in a film that is so remarkably subtle and nuanced, and in a sense forbearing in the way in which characters perform, this is really one of the few really broad touches that Long allows anyone.
I agree.
Den Kindermörder!
Was? Wen?
Den Kindermörder, Herr Kommissar.
Augenblick.
We've had this long scene in the bank building. The final sequence will take us to yet another space, this distillery. How would you understand the fact that this reference to a levy, the reference to the fact that it went out of business during the inflation period?
It is mentioned that they went out of business in the inflation in 1923-24. By 1931, the effects of the stock market crash have reached Germany and unemployment was on the rise. Almost 500,000 people were out of work in 1930 in Berlin alone, without social welfare. Those who had jobs had their incomes slashed. Both communist and national socialist parties have managed to increase their numbers, obviously, in those times. Hitler's Nazi party managed to increase their seats in the decisive elections of fall 1930, from 12 to 107 seats. That was the decisive election in September of 1930, just about when the film was ready to be shot. So as we've seen, the film lifts the heavy cloud of economic depression only with occasional touches of black humor that are supposed to be characteristic of Berliners.
Ja. Ja.
As Beckert turns, then we get this remarkably prolonged pan.
Completely silent.
Yeah, silent throughout, uncannily so. But look how slow this pan is, how drawn out, how it opens up the space, shows us this mass, this very silent, serious, solemn mass. And then contrasted to that is the frenetic and passionate outburst of Beckert.
Hilfe! Hilfe! Lass mich raus! Lass mich raus! Ich will ihn aus! Ich will ihn aus! Lass mich doch raus!
Hier kommst du nicht mehr raus.
Aber meine Herren, ich bitte Sie, ich weiß gar nicht, was Sie von mir wollen. Ich bitte Sie, lassen Sie mich doch frei. Das Ganze muss doch ein Irrtum sein. Ein Irrtum.
Oh nein. Kein Irrtum.
It is striking in this film where we see mothers mourn their children who have been murdered, that not a single male figure mourns the death of a child except for the murderer himself, the murderer who will repeat the words Elsie, 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 just as the mother has said the same thing earlier in the film, that in a sense the only act of mourning by a male in this film is done by the murderer.
Elsie, Elsie, nein, nein, nein!
Wo hast du die kleine Makaperl verscharrt, du Hund?
Aber die habe ich ja, die habe ich ja gar nicht gekannt.
Ach, die hast du gar nicht gekannt. Die auch nicht, was? Und die? Und die hast du auch nicht gekannt, was?
The world we see in this film is this hyper-modern world, and people are, in a sense, machine savvy, as we've seen at various moments. Except Lorre, or that is to say, Beckert is not. Beckert is, you might even say he's an anachronism, that in this world of functional types, he somehow is too much of an individual, too much subjectivity in this world, let us say, where people have become far more streamlined in their personalities.
Yeah, that's a good point. He doesn't fit. I mean, you can actually see it physically that he doesn't fit. He's, compared to all the Angular Prussian figures, he's typecast as somebody coming from Austria. He was actually born in Hungary, and he speaks the southern dialect, and his whole body language, his whole body is a different one than those around him. And so in that sense, he is marked as different.
He's marked as different insofar as he is, these exotic fruit shops, again, being framed between pineapples, you know, marking him as different, but also, in a sense, a southern kind of difference. I mean, how far is that to, let us say, Jewish stereotypes?
I mean, the Orientalist quality that comes through the Südfrüchte, that's a very good point. I mean, Peter Lorre was born as Laszlo Lohenstein in a small town in Hungary, and he assumed the stage name Peter Lorre when he worked in Vienna. And he came to Berlin in the mid-20s when he was invited to work with Brecht. And he was relatively unknown, actually, when Fritz Lang discovered him on stage and when he persuaded him to act in M.
But he was playing in Brecht's Mann ist Mann. He was playing Galligay, which is about, in a sense, the pliability of an individual, how one, you know, subjectivity literally can be molded and shaped by larger forces.
I think that's what fascinated Lang about Lorre, that this round childlike face and the corpulent body that is not, as I said before, not unlike Hamann, seem to conceal some demonic force that could erupt at any moment. And he's both the good uncle and he's also the child murderer. That this is possible in one figure, I think this is what fascinated Lang. And I think Lorre's acting, in fact, emphasizes the split between himself and his deeds, leading the audience to wonder who he really is.
dein Leben lang auf Staatskosten verpflegt wirst.
In that sense, this film, for all of its realism, for all its, you know, in a sense, social emphasis, does take us back to the haunted screen of earlier Weimar cinema, insofar as we see this individual who has this monster in him. But we see the monstrosity not as some sort of uncanny effect, but as a social product.
That is a very good point. And it's not actually pursued in the film itself. We don't quite know how he became what he is, except that his psychological disposition, be it the result of shell shock in the First World War, which I think it is, or another trauma that he has not mastered, whatever it is, it basically drives him. And this comes out, of course, in this famous monologue where he has full stage time, like a stage actor, and the camera respects that, where he says, I'm being pursued by myself. So he is actually two figures in one.
I mean, that takes us back to, of course, the doubles, the doppelganger, the, you know, one of these quintessential motifs of Weimar cinema, takes us back also, obviously, to romantic literature of the 19th century.
Exactly. And this is, so to speak, the classical aspect, the expressionistic strand that goes through the film, the doppelganger motif, of course, also reinforced by the lighting, as we said before, and by this whole, I would say, expressionistic acting that is unpredictable, that is highly stylized.
Du willst also damit sagen, dass du morden musst.
And this will be the bravado moment for Lorre in this film. As this scene unfolds, more and more the camera will hold on him. We will have long takes that allow this amazing performance to have its own visual integrity. Long allows this performance quite literally to breathe.
Ja, manchmal ist mir, als ob ich selber hinter mir herliefe. Ich will davon, von mir selber davonlaufen. Aber ich kann mir nicht entkommen. Muss den Weg gehen, den es mich jagt. Muss rennen, rennen, endlose Straßen. Ich will weg.
It is typical that we think of and talk about as a Fritz Lang film. Perhaps that's an injustice. This is equally a Peter Lorre film.
Definitely. I think M made Lorre a film star, and I would also maintain that Lorre made M into the film that we know to a fault, in the sense that the film stuck with Peter Lorre throughout his career. And when he came back in 1950 to Germany, all he could do is make another film about a serial killer. It's called Der Verlorene, Lost One.
Yeah, it shaped his star sign in a way that it was hard to come out of the shadow of M for him.
Exactly. And there was apparently, from what I've read, constant confusions between his acting role and the person. So he was always considered to be a monster, somebody who is unstable and potentially criminal.
And of course, the most blatant moment where that happens is in Fritz Hippler's film The Eternal Jew, where the passionate outcry of this tormented murderer is held to be the true mark of a Jew, and in a sense the performance, Lorre's performance, is read in somehow as a documentary for the way in which Jews act in the rhetoric of that film.
Der Angeklagte hat gesagt, dass nicht anders kann. Das heißt also, dass morden muss. Und damit hat sich selber sein Todesurteil gesprochen. Ein Mensch, der von sich selber sagt, dass zwangsweise fremdes Leben vernichtet, dieser Mensch muss ausgelöscht werden wie ein Schafenfeuer. Wow. Dieser Mensch muss ausgerottet werden. Dieser Mensch muss weg.
So much of what we've seen about this film has been dialogical. You recall the earlier scenes of so-called warring discourses, and we get the kind of strained situations that really knows no middle ground in terms of these one reverse angle and another reverse angle and these positions that simply are in contradiction. And in a way, this film is mobilizing a large number of the concerns that were very much in the public sphere at this very dramatic point in the history of the Weimar Republic. And this last sequence you could understand as a function of these warring discourses, the discourse about capital punishment. And the German experience with capital punishment is really something that is not readily comparable to that of the United States. At the time, in actual fact, capital punishment was rather rare in Germany.
Exactly, and it was administered in the case of Grossmann and in the case of Hamann, and it was administered in the case of Kürten. All of them fully convicted mass murderers, but in general, it is true that there were hardly any death penalty convictions in the Weimar Republic.
And this film, you know, which is constantly playing with doubles and playing with twosomes, will leave us with two different verdicts, one which is quite conclusive, you could even say apodictic, of course, but it's a verdict that is not carried out. And we will then have a closing scene where a verdict is passed, but really not pronounced, at least in a way that is legible to us, except perhaps by inference in the response of the mothers. But it really is not a verdict that is fully articulated. And for that reason, it's suggestive. And for that reason, it also leaves us with a conclusion that has a certain element of aperture that, in a sense, puts it back on the spectator, back on the you who is spoken to in the final line of the film. This film then, that in the end doesn't say the end, but leaves that end, any conclusion, to a thinking spectator.
Fahr doch die Mütter! Die Mütter sollst du fahren! Was sagst du denn, dass du von den Müttern Gnade für den Mörder ihrer Kinder erlangen wirst?
What Lorre's monologue does in many ways is, of course, a restaging of the crime in front of the others. It's basically a public revisiting of the crime in order to reclaim the moment of the original trauma being having to kill in the war, even though he did not want to. Sigmund Freud has an interesting passage in 1918 where he says that the peace ego and the war ego are worrying. The peace ego says, I do not want to kill, and the war ego says, I have to kill in order not to be killed. And that kind of double bind leads to breakdown. In a way, one could say that Lorre reenacts this double bind, this trauma.
Again, this expressive use of off-screen space, a reaction to something or someone we don't see, but in a sense whose presence is palpable. Even the otherwise powerful shrinker is forced to raise his arms in the end. Yet another arm, another hand, and a disembodied force cut to another space and to another court and yet to another judgment, a judgment that will be pronounced but in a sense will be passed in a way that is not audible for us except by inference. We are, as in Kafka, once again before the law. The film began with mothers waiting for their children. The film ends with grieving mothers, a threesome, a kind of ironic reference to the three fates, except these women are victims of fate, of a social destiny, and that social destiny is one that involves a larger social unit, the you, that is the last word of this film, the you that is us and is the audience.